Welcome back, everyone. We will now move into the final panel discussion for the 10th edition of the annual Academic Conference 2021. The panel is titled Land Governance and Social Transformation. It will be moderated by Professor Solomon Benjamin of the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, IIT Madras. We will start this panel discussion with a small introduction about the topic of discussion from Professor Benjamin Solomon.
Let's start off. We have three presentations. Mukesh Kumar, space specialty in vernacularization, who's talking about the land regularization of a particular neighborhood in Patna, a very contested space. Jatin, Mukesh is from, by the way, this. Jatin, who's from JNU, is talking about Dalit housing spaces, environment and economic aspect, and he'll be also focusing on what does it mean to be categorized as a Dalit? You know, what kind of spaces does it open up, close up? And Vipita, who's from the CDS, is looking at the speciality of an urban settlement in Trivandrum Corporation. And again, here the complexities of being evicted, resettled, and all of them are really interesting because of They are dealing with some of the very core issues about speciality as both as a method or fieldwork, but also as a kind of analytical kind of lens. So thank you very much. And each of them will be given 15 minutes, and then we'll have hopefully 15 minutes of Q&A and maybe a very quick 3-minute wrap up. I'm trimming it a bit because we started late. We lost some time in these connections. Okay, thank you very much. I'm just going to, can you all hear me? And now we can start with Mukesh. Okay. Please unmute yourself, Mukesh, and if you want to share your screen, etc.
Yes, sir, I wanted to present PPT as well.
Sure, you can please share your screen. Yeah. Yes, we can see the screen. Yeah, wait.
Okay, so, hello? Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Sure.
I'll be talking about the development trajectory of a settlement, which is upper and dominant caste and class neighborhood in Patna. And this work is part of my doctoral thesis. And the title of this paper is State Speciality and Vernacularization of Democracy in Patna. So basically, I will be dealing with three concepts, state, vernacularization of democracy, and how these two concepts or processes has been very instrumental for development of a speciality, which is very distinctive and exclusionary in nature, and which also reinforces caste hierarchy and inequality in city. So the nature of state has been changing since inception of Indian state after independence. Change is an inevitable process, and the observers claim that Indian state was provider, facilitator, now moving towards mediation. Therefore, it's important and relevant to understand changing nature of state in fast urbanizing North Indian cities. It is also important because the nature of state determines state-society relationship, where society is very diverse in nature. There is agreement amongst the scholar that the state is fragmented and mediation is important. But there is disagreement among them, that is, why mediation takes place. These differences are from two different set of literature, where one talks about mediation takes place because of economic interest, and another set of literature don't see mediation purely driven by economic interest. So recently, sociological and anthropological literature has explained how the state is not a monolithic but a heterogeneous entity and heterogeneous and fragmented entity composed of numerous competing actors and institutions. And therefore it would not be a mistake to call Indian state is a constituent of multiple sovereignties and breaking the notion that the sovereignty is vested with Indian state. In Bihar, popular sovereignty has in practice mean the rule of certain caste groups or alliances of caste groups as determined through the electoral processes. So the question raised here is that what is the nature of state functioning for development of the settlement, that is Rajiv Nagar, where what is nature of state in the context of land transformation and construction? Because all, as Chakravarti mentioned, all the competing elements of Indian society appear to have converged on a single issue, that is land, or to be more specific, changes in land use, land conversion, and ownership. A struggle over land have in many ways been fundamental to evolution of politics, economy, and culture in countries. It is relevant to understand because of many reasons, democratic values and spaces are under stress. Observers pointed that democratic decision decline or retreat across the globe. Scholars have also mentioned that there is an array of factors that have been contributed to this recent stress on democracy. And crux of the problem is that state capacity in many new and existing democracies has not kept pace with popular demands for democratic accountability. Therefore, it is worth exploring and understanding the state functioning and also the way in which democracy functions. So when democracy, as existing literature also discussed, that when democracy entered into a environment, it became vernacular. And understanding vernacular means and process will help us to understand democratic functioning better. So how vernacular means and process have been instrumental for democratic practices for development of the settlement, that is Rajiv Nagar. There is also a body of literature that talks about the third world urban centers are growing rapidly, irrespective of its size and economy. More infrastructure and services are needed to fulfill demand of increasing population in urban centers. We observed that the government had taken initiative through economic reform, land reform, financial aid, subsidy, etc., where new actors sometimes emerge, sometimes created, sometimes developed, and sometimes invited for development of the cities. So Patna, its medium capital city, is going very fast, and more in last few decades, the urbanization rate is very fast, have increased very fast in last few decades. So what is outcome of development of this transformation, both in terms of changes in land use and also in terms of how it interact with diverse society? Because we less know about day-to-day commodification of land and housing within cities, especially smaller cities. To understand this, I have done 1 year of ethnographic fieldwork at Rajiv Nagar, which is peripheral, a part of city, now it's becoming heart of the city, where triangulation of method and data as well have been maintained to understand better how to understand the process of trajectory of development of the city. So the paper argues that the upper dominant caste groups focus on combining more modern associational forms like cooperative housing societies, sangha samiti, and older social hierarchies of caste and class in their project of occupying, regularizing, and valorizing Rajiv Nagar. These modern associational forms produced a certain kind of social space which is distinctive, exclusory in nature. So now I'll be talking about findings, and there is three slides for findings. It's not very separate, all these three. First is occupying land. Second is how unauthorized construction and regularization process has been taking place. And third is how the Rajiv Nagar has been valorizing. So basically, it started in 1971 when Congress rule government has promulgated an ordinance to establish Bihar State Housing Board to develop an increasing housing infrastructure, to develop housing infrastructure to cater increasing population in the city. And at that time, it was combined Bihar and Jharkhand. So the role given to the board was to develop the housing infrastructure across the city. One of the projects that Bihar State Housing Board has brought is for Digha land, that is now part of Patna Municipal Corporation jurisdiction. But before that, the board was established by promulgating ordinances, and that ordinances was repromulgated 10 times by the governor of the state. And in 2017 January, the constitutional bench of Supreme Court has given a judgment Krishna Kumar Singh and others versus the state of Bihar that the repromulgation of ordinances is unconstitutional. And also, more than 10 years of functioning of Bihar State Housing Board was not put before the legislature. So it, in a sense, the working of the housing board was considered to be unconstitutional in a certain way, because at that time only this board has launched this public housing scheme and the district magistrate Patna has notified the area of Digha land, and the Digha land was around 1,000 acres, and 4.35 acres land was single out belongs to a dominant and upper caste family, and Supreme Court has termed this family Pandey family. Actually, he was a relative of then Chief Minister Bihar, and because of this acquiring of land, whole land acquisition process was delayed, and then agreed farmer went to the Patna High Court, and it took some time Patna High Court to give their judgment, and then that judgment was in favor of state government. Then again, the farmers went up to the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court given their judgment in 1984. By the time the year from 1974 to 1984, 10 years of period has given scope for land settler to settle these state acquired land. In that judgment, Supreme Court has validated the procedure of land acquisition, but also they have directed the state and Bihar State Housing Board to pay compensation to the farmers and also acquire the acquired land. But the government has not provided compensation to the farmers and also not acquired the acquired land. In that case, the agri farmer, they started selling their land to the third party. Actually, it was planned effort by the person who was close to political regime, and they have their alliance with the government. Why? Because then when Supreme Court has given judgment, then there was no money in district magistrates of treasury to pay compensation to the farmer, and documents says that was the deliberate effort by the political regime to withdraw that money so that compensation could not be paid to the farmers. Again, after changing and regime, when RJD came to power, somehow the land was encroached. More than 300 to 400 acres of land was encroached, and some building was constructed at that time. But then the RJD regime came to power, then construction, unauthorized construction was stopped. And RJD regime established Bihar State Housing, Rajiv Nagar Police Station to control the unauthorized construction. But for 10, 15 years, it was controlled construction. But once the political regime changes in 2004-05, immediately the rate of construction has increased. And within 2-3 years, one part of the notified area is covered by unauthorized construction. Though there is police station established by the government just to control the unauthorized construction, and also Bihar State Housing Board has one office in Rajiv Nagar. But these two offices combined started extorting money by the resident those were doing unauthorized construction. And also they have association and alliances with different levels of state circuits, and also they have alliances among the residents. They have formed association called Rajiv Nagar Sangharsh Samiti Morcha. That is basically association of residents, those who have been part of this land bank making, plotting and selling them through power of attorney. And cooperative housing society has played a crucial role in this process, because the land settler, they have formed the cooperative housing society, they have taken land from farmers through power of attorney, then they have distributed this land to their known one, close one, relatives, colleagues, friends and fellow villagers or regions. And that's why we see that cooperative society names is also named on their business, Mithila Housing Society, etc. So after 2005, the political regime had changed. Earlier, the settlers and residents were very close to Congress because they were the ruling in center as well as in state. And that's why we see the name of the unauthorized settlement was named after late Rajiv Gandhi. And that's called Rajiv Nagar, Rajiv Nagar. Now, the state started thinking into direction to recognize it when Patna High Court has taken issues of Rajiv Nagar in hand, and then they started directing the government to come up with some solution to regularize the settlement, because there are so many state functionaries, they have built their house in Rajiv Nagar. So the profile of their household is like this. They have sitting judges, they have registrar, they have sitting, they have working bureaucrats, retired bureaucrats, also defense staff, ex-ministers, politicians, sitting ministers, politicians, all. So it's like association at all levels. It's this association of dominant caste and also upper caste. So they all come together, they bring different social and professional skill to the table, and they try to associate, and they associate all level of states, considering the suspension of regulation initially, and then after 2004-05 they started negotiating for their regularization. The NDA government has taken initiative to regularize this unauthorized settlement. And then in 2014, they come up with Digha Land Settlement Scheme. And that was conditional basis, that the settlement has to pay money to the Bihar State Housing Board as per 2013 Land Acquisition Act. That was three times of circle rate of that vicinity. So now the rate is 9 lakh per katha. So one has to pay 30 lakh per katha, including registry fees. So residents are not willing to pay this amount. But the residents, they are paying revenue and the taxes to the state, but they are not getting residence certificate. They don't have ownership right, but they are getting all basic services and amenities, and all development work is taking place coming from center and state governments. Now, after 2000,
I have about half a minute left. maybe we can take some of the details in the Q&A.
Okay.
Yeah, so we can wrap up very fast. Thank you.
So can I speak 2-3 minutes? Hello.
If you can present your main findings, in half a minute, because we are already over 15 minutes. Yeah, thank you.
So I will just conclude the findings. So it was agriculture land and it turned into a private colony. Recent official document like Master Plan, Patna Master Plan 2031, it terms it as a private colony. It was actually a home building project. It turned into real estate development project. Ownership has changed because the land used to belong to the non-dominant caste. That was Koyri, Kurmi, and Yadav. Now it is majority of them residents are dominant upper caste. Development, the settlement is very distinct and exclusionary in nature. Developed associational mechanism at various level has undermined democratic functioning, and that reinforces hierarchy and inequality, caste hierarchy and inequality. So can we say that the functioning of democracy is more social than political, what we imagined and what we expect? Thank you.
Now we will have the next session by Jatin, who will make a presentation. And Jatin, if you can keep to your time, so that we'll keep enough time for Q&A. Thank you. I may ask Mukesh to stop sharing, and then therefore Jatin can.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I'd just like to thank the organizers for giving me a chance to present my paper over here. This paper is also part of my larger PhD project, which is about Dalit housing and settlements in Delhi over the 20th century, and taking the contemporary period also in towards the epilogue period. So today's paper that I want to
Jatin, we can't hear you. If you can just check your sound again. Hi, Jatin, we can't hear you.
Which, hello, am I not audible?
Now you are audible.
Okay, thank you. So I just start from the introduction again. I'm just talking about the trajectory of my paper, which is titled Dalit Housing in Delhi, Economic and Environmental Aspects. So I'll first start with a few quotes from the history, as it is a history-based paper, historical paper. And then I'll move on to introducing my paper, then having some bit of historiography, and then I'll talk about the economic aspects like the materiality and aspects which are related, interrelated to it, for example, the nomenclature and a bit of the political issues. Then I'll move on to the environmental aspects and then probably conclude it. So I'll just request one of you to give me a kind of alarm when 5 minutes are left, so that I can wrap up towards the end. So, to begin with, I'll start with a quote by Rameshwari Nehru. Rameshwari Nehru was in 1937, she had worked for the quote unquote Harijan Bastis in Delhi, and she also became the president of Dalit Rehabilitation Board when the partition of the Indian subcontinent had happened in 1947. So she had commented this in around 1940s that this is particularly about the Dalit Bastis in Delhi. I quote, "I have seen scores of Harijan Bastis all over India. It forms a story tale all over the country. But I was not prepared for the terrible sight that met my eyes in Delhi. Used though I am to seeing poverty and the condition attendant on poverty, the surroundings in which Delhi sweepers live gave me the shock of my life. Never before I have ever seen even sweepers living in such filthy conditions. The whole sight and the atmosphere is suffocating, and it was painful to stay there at any length of time. In the rainy season, I have been told that the filth in the liquid forms comes right to the verandas of the sweepers. I do not want to make any attempt of describing these abodes of human misery. They defy all descriptions. Unquote. The next quote is by Mahatma Gandhi. He made this when he had visited Delhi towards the independence only. So he quoted, and this was also published in his paper Harijan. It was basically in Hindi, so I'll first read the Hindi and then translation of it that I have made. अपनी आंखों से देखे बिना तुम लोग कल्पना तक नहीं कर सकते कि दुनिया में इंसान के रहने के लिए ऐसे भी स्थान हो सकते हैं। इस बस्ती को देखने के बाद खाना पीना तक अच्छा नहीं लगता, देखते ही जैसे उल्टी सी आती है। वहां ऐसी गंदगी थी उसका वर्णन करने के लिए मेरे पास शब्द तक नहीं है। Dalits who have also migrated to the city throughout the 20th century. Before that, I'll just begin with introducing the Dalit term itself and how I'm using it. Dalit, originating from the Sanskrit word Dalita, fundamentally means oppressed or downtrodden. And according to Anupama Rao, it was first used by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in his newspaper by Shrimad Bharat in 1928. And later this term was revived by Dalit Panther movements by activists and other Dalit intellectuals, particularly in 1970s onwards. And it is basically referred to, and here in this context, I'm basically using it to refer to the ex-intelligible castes within Delhi throughout the period. However, these basically included classes like or the caste like Bavariya, Chamar, Chidimar, Khatik, Kohli, Chura, Dagi, Dhanak, Urmi, Lodha, Ragar, and Sasi, and others like Nai, Teli, Julahar, Rubis, etc. However, this composition has also changed over time. To give you a brief about this changing composition over time, I'll just tell you that towards the beginning of the 20th century, when census was conducted in 1931, we see that only 8 communities were enlisted into the fold of depressed classes. This was the term used for the Dalits then. These included Bhangis or sweepers, Chamars or shoemakers. These were the actual terms which are used in the census over there. So basically there was a mix of occupational identity and the caste identity or the community identity in the colonial papers. By 1951, basically the mid of the century, we see there were 36 Dalit communities which were officially recognized in Delhi as the scheduled castes. In terms of numbers, by the mid of the century, every 1 out of 10 persons was the Dalit within the city. So basically 10% were there. And by the end of the century, we see that this has actually doubled, and every 2 out of 10 persons in Delhi were Dalits. So Dalit constituted almost 20% of the population in Delhi. As one can argue that Dalits have been a significant part of the history of settlement of the city throughout the 20th century. However, the problem lies that when a survey was conducted by Bharat Seva Samaj post independence from the colonial period, we see that the survey has actually showed that this proportion was much higher in the quote unquote slum areas. So, in Delhi and its rural environments, and the studies also will also analyze how social marginalization has taken shape and got reproduced in urban spatial geography. This emerges, for instance, in the official and unofficial nomenclatures used for the Dalit bastis. And through tracing the historical pattern, I'll also look at what was the impact that the urbanization process had on the living conditions of those who migrated to the city. And the study will not only look at the ways in which caste and community structures had operated as stigmatizing and marking factors, but also how in certain contexts they could also act as politically quote-unquote enabling force, as caste had also provided a unifying and organizing point, a platform which Dalits sought to acquire some leverage in municipal affairs and make claims to civic amenities and space in the city. And the paradox was that in order to assert these rights, Dalits had to actually accept and in fact prove their lower social status. Within the city, most of the land is actually used for the purpose of housing, including in Delhi. And so I'll basically look at the spatial, economic and environmental aspects, particularly the housing aspects of the Delhi settlements, including the materiality of the housing structures, the nomenclature, and its subsequent impact on the legality of Dalit housing and settlements in the urban cityscape. Economic aspects in Dalit housing will include discussions on rent, lease of lands and housing, and settlements as a site of production as well as reproduction. It is also pertinent to investigate how much the modern planning of the city post the establishment of the Delhi Development Authority, which is also, as it calls itself, as the ninth planner of the city. We have to see that how much the modern planning actually catered to the needs of the occupation of the communities. And a characterization of certain occupations as were actually done as obnoxious trade, in which Dalit communities were involved and had an impact on the settlements and subsequently their lives. The trope of health and environment was actually used as a tool by the state to shape the urban city as per their need. The analysis of the environment of politics and in allotment of housing sites and its implementation will basically try to comment on this. So I think I'll need more time, so I'm just basically skipping up the historiographic part. I'll talk about the bit about the politics of allocation of land and housing, and how the schematization was done and how it actually worked on the ground level. So the emergence of various political organizations happened who contested for the representation of the list, that actually proved as both as a boon as well as a bane for the Dalit lot in Delhi. And the social political organizations which emerged at the helm of the identity politics engaged in fire struggle to take charge of improvement of Dalit settlements through the state sanctions. And politics has been involved in allotment of and implementation of housing schemes which were meant for Dalits. The involvement of state and its agencies, particularly the Delhi Municipality, Ministry of Health, Delhi Improvement Trust, and in the post-colonial period agencies including Ministry of Rehabilitation and Delhi Development Authority in the allotment of housing to Dalits, highlight different aspects of caste politics. The state and its agencies dealt with Dalits through the mediation of organizations for Dalits, like the Depressed Classes Association, Dalit Udhar Sabha, Salvation Army, Harijan Sevak Sangh, Harijan Welfare Board, Displaced Harijan Rehabilitation Board, etc. The term of mediations were not free floating. Scholars like Vijay Prasad and Anishwanayar Ramanayak have already pointed out an interplay of caste politics within the Gandhian and nationalist mobilization, and Hindu politics also involved into it. In context of housing, the Hindu intervention in Dalit issues led to involvement of agencies like Dalit Uddhar Sabha, a unit of Hindu quote-unquote militant, this was the term used by Vijay Prasad, in colonial attempts of housing the Dalits. In August 1925, we see that the commissioner of Delhi gave the charge. This is basically an example of such a scheme in which the housing was to be given for the Dalits or the depressed class, which was the term called then, and how it actually turned out with the mediation and what was the politics involved. So in August 25, we see that the commissioner of Delhi gave the charge of making recommendations and allotment of votes in a proposed capacity for depressed classes to Dalit Uddhar Sabha, which had applied for the sanction of this lease. However, in 1931, another association called All India Depressed Classes Association raised flag against the mediation that this organization, Dalit Uddhar Sabha, is a quote-unquote caste Hindu RS Samajist organization, and accused the organization of wrong distribution of plots of land meant for the depressed classes. And this was not the sole case when charges of wrong or illegitimate allotment of lands meant for the Dalits were posed. In case of Shaltanand Basti and another Basti which was proposed for depressed classes in the colonial period, the irregularities of allotment of schemes were quite sharp. We saw that the Basti was proposed for the depressed classes by the colonial administration in around 1925. However, the scheme and
Jatin, I think we lost you. Can you hear us?
Percent of the remaining plots in that area also were not given to the depressed classes, but other classes, including Rajputs and other higher castes. Also, there was a very prolonged 11 years of which had actually taken up in this implementation. So such questions were asked that what kind of what was the reasons. However, there was no proper answer which was given by the authorities on these allegations. In the history of Dalit settlements from above, in most of the cases, the concern for settlement and housing did not come from states or others' response to the dire inequality and social evils in the society. Rather, we see that the settlement from above, which means from the side of the state and its agencies, it was actually carried by it because of its own needs and necessities or political legitimacies, or rather it was these were basically resettlements instead of of continuous displacement. The very terminology used for them, which is basti, slum, etc., has suggested that they could be demolished without much attention to the legal rights, and that it was a benevolent demolition because of the settlements were characterized as unfit for the human habitation. And the variety of materials used in building of different types of housing and settlements is worth noticing. The materials used for building and construction of different kinds of structures also goes under change over a period of time. The kind of materials used for construction also determines its classification into the legal terminologies. construction materials with acknowledged stability like bricks, cement, stones, etc. gives the built structure the identification of pakka structure or stable structure. On the other hand, materials like tin sheds, mud, thatch, wood, etc. are considered as unstable or temporary. Therefore, the structures built with these materials are characterized as temporary, kaccha, poor or slums. This kind of classification therefore delegitimizes these latter structures as unfit for the urban areas and stamps them as illegal slums which need to be cleared off. This legal implication becomes a major threat for the structures like slums and bustis, which are even characterized through the kind of materials used for them. Some of the settlements in Delhi.
Definitely, I may ask you to wrap up very fast. Yeah, is that okay with you? Yes. Just to give enough time to, so we can take a minute or so just to wrap up because we need to have a third presentation.
Yeah. Actually, I had and then the details for, can
come. Yeah, the details can come. For,
Thanks. Comment about bit of the environmental factors then, and then probably I will discuss more about the conclusion in the question answer session. Basically, I was waiting for interruption at 5 minutes. I thought that somebody will interrupt me. I thought that I had time. Anyway, about the environmental factors. So ecology and environmental factors are critical to analyze and have a comprehensive understanding of any comprehensive understanding of the space. In context of Delhi and its environment, Avadhendra Sharan's work is an important one, but it also does not deal with the aspects and the housing and the environment over there. So apart from the kind of pollution particularly described by within the quotes that we have seen, we also see that this kind of representation of pollution packed with description of fumes and filth is there in other literature also, in the fiction literature also. Mulk Rajanand in his novel Untouchable has also portrayed this, and the official understanding of a slum area or a slum is also indicated towards this. And if you see the master plan of Delhi in 1962 also, we see that over there also most of the bustis which were asked to be refurbished or relocated, out of the 17 bustis, 90% of the bustis were Dalit bustis, and although they were not earmarked as Dalit bustis, but if you see the composition of the people, around 75% of the dwellers in these bustis were Dalits only. So on the basis of the environmental factors like lack of space or more density or lack of proper portable water and so forth, the buses were also characterized as slums, which also had legal implications. So if I very briefly just in two lines, if I talk about the conclusion of this. The process of concentration of the list into community pockets or certain slums only was not a free and natural one. It was enforced from the above through the instances like allotment and resettlement of the list by state and its agencies to segregated colonies and margins of Delhi. We can see the work of people like Vasudev Indra and all. We'll get to know that this happened during the partition also, and later also this has happened in the, if you see the master plans and all. Thus, as expected by the thinkers and social workers like B.R. Ambedkar, cities could not bring emancipation to the extent as it was expected. And the built material which is used for the housing and the settlements are like, is its nomenclature, categorization into official documents. All these factors have a real-time impact on the legality as well as the development issues of the Basti. Environmental and ecological factors in Delhi, the resettlements, as compared to the city as a whole, express a stark disparity and inhuman conditions of living in terms of the open spaces, the parks, gardens, or basic amenities. And this makes them as well as their settlements prone to stigma, and the residents of that place prone to the disease and health issues. the economic aspect of housing underscore the precarious nature of Delhi settlements, which cut across the everyday existence and lived experiences in multifaceted ways. The informal settlements and the legal terminologies used for their inhabited space form an integral of their everyday experiences. The policymakers have tried to portray their settlements as blots and inhuman, and instead of working for its redevelopment and ensuring the basic civil amenities, the policymakers have suggested a relocation of the settlements to the fringes of the city. In this light, the dwellers faced eviction threats which they tried to dodge, and this formed a core basis of resistance between the city planners and the residents. This equation in, the equation in this interplay of enforcement and resistance have largely decided the fate of the settlements within the city. So I'll just
Stop. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll now have the last presentation, and do you want to share your screen, Vipita?
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, I think it is visible, no?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, okay. Okay, the paper is titled Speciality of Subaltern Urban Settlement in Thiruvananthapuram Corporation, Kerala, which is a case study. So regarding the introduction, I must say that the subaltern space and subaltern caste identities are positioned in the larger framework of Kerala model of development. The Kerala model discourse, if you see, the outcome of achievements in social development has negotiated the outlier communities, and the process of exclusion is continuing. So this paper is basically an ethnographic account which intends to bring the stories concomitant with the speciality of an urban slum in Trivandrum Corporation in selected aspects of socio-political life there. So here, I have given much significance to the writing or the history of the subaltern space. So the title Subaltern Space, which I would like to confer, since it is a pure resurrection of the subaltern history, and it finds its way from the subaltern voices. So here it is not limited to the geographical area of their living or the history alone. Rather, it derives the present and articulates the speciality which is investigated through the extensive interviews of the people at MSK Nagar and around. So here, space is understood as a product of interrelations. So speciality, by speciality, I mean the intrinsic relation between space and power. So as I have already described, it includes the history of the two settlements, the place of origin, which is Karimadam, and the place they live now, that is MSK Nagar. So here I use the method of ethnohistory, producing narratives from the ethnographic fieldwork. So there are enough instances when you look at the literature like Skaria, Banerjee, Dubey, who explains the historical and anthropological exploration of ex-untouchables and heretical caste formations. So here I try to analyze how subalternity is established in the urban Phulaya community at MSK Nagar. So here, when you look at the framework, usually when we talk about the cities of the global south, we discuss more about the developmentalism, just like what Jennifer Robinson has called like the problems of underdevelopment. But unlike that, there is some significance to the history of the space that creates speciality associated with each space, city, and the fringes. So drawing the post-colonial theory, I define the term subaltern in an urban context that creates speciality associated with each space, city, and its fringes. So subaltern geography, therefore, I perceive as the geographical imagination of the subaltern subjects or groups who are marginalized in the face of power. So I perceive subaltern as an agent of time that brings change. So here I would like to add Ananya Roy's concept of subaltern urbanism. So for Ananya Roy, a slum is an archetypal imaginary of a megacity. But slums in Kerala, when you look at, they are unlike that of Dharavi, which is a community or a society within themselves. So it is kind of a parallel society to us. So I look at the two settlements. One is a pre-settlement, that is a squatter illegal settlement. The latter is a government-produced settlement. So the people at MSK Nagar got dispossessed from the original settlement and they are resettled into a new space. So when you look at the pre-settlement Karimadam, so this is This is the part of an interview I have conducted with Kunyu Kutiyamma. She is 100 years old. So from reading this, what we can understand is Karimadam appears like an abjad space where two prominent groups, the Dalits and Muslims, were settled. So there were the problems of overcrowding, and as well as there were conflict between the Dalits and the Muslims living there. So in 1962, 100 families were resettled into MSK Nagar, and currently they are settling in MSK Nagar. So when you look at MSK Nagar, it is one of the oldest slums in Trivandrum, located in the Kuvayathi ward of Manakkad region of East Fort, close to the Artigal temple, which is the prominent Hindu temple in Kerala. So the place was initially in the form of a thop, that means a garden, which was under the kingdom of Sri Chittira Thirunal, who used the place for recreation and leisure. So from the Malayalam word Shringara Thopu, meaning orchard to play around, the name Shringara Thopu came. So there is a kind of contested toponymy. Like the current name of the settlement is MSK Nagar, but there is less acceptance to the name, in the sense that the name of the slum, they believe that the name of the slum do not come with the suffix Nagar. So it is kind of a, there is some kind of caste dynamics under it. So in that way, MSK Nagar, when you look at it is in an area of 9 acres separated from the rest of the locality by a wall. The settlement is currently completely an urban space, though not into the heart of the city. The city corporation has implemented a multitude of programs as a part of the JNNURM from 2005 onwards. So at the time of formation, 100 families were only there. Later in 1964, 25 more houses were also constructed to accommodate sewage and sanitation workers of the corporation. While shifting to MSK Nagar, they were offered a bowl to eat, a randal, a lantern, two glasses, and a steel hanging board, and also a temporary document of title deed. So when you look at the spatial transformation of the settlement, also you can find that it is taking place over a period of time. Like the houses were electrified, the markets, the earlier the markets were in a very far location, then markets were developing in the nearer area and like that. So when you look at the land ownership, housing and living of the people living there, the colony inmates experienced social and economic marginalization. The government conferred on an average 4 cents of land to them, but over generation, due to the subdivisions, land holding became less than less. So housing renovation also, when you look at it, did not take place properly. Hence, there are profound questions in terms of the delivery of proper housing and their engagement as citizens in developing solutions. So hence it shows the demand for ensuring the proper implementation of the urban slum development programs. So it requires the recognition of underlying power asymmetries in framing an urban policy. Now, looking at the caste identity and the process of othering, here I use the notion of self and othering on the Hegelian generalization. So caste here is perceived as a hierarchical differentiation that the elites perform power creating the self and other. So my idea here is to start an analytical starting point for understanding the cultural process of identity formation and how the people are resisting. The Dalits are subjected to intersectional othering. Intersectional othering in the sense that one is from the location and one is from the caste. So there is kind of intersectional othering. So you can see that the two types of othering is happening in the lives of the people at MSK Nagar, the in-group othering and out-group othering. While in-group othering, I can say that while interviewing the Iriva family, which is an OBC category, I could identify that they consider Dalits as other. So there are several instances of out-group othering as well. There are a few instances also in the paper, but I'll discuss while in the question answer session. So here it would be adequate to discuss the resistance from the process of othering. So when you look at the people of MSK Nagar, we can identify that they change their religious belief through Pentecostal conversions. Here, prayers create a new social space and a no social imaginary. So, irrespective of the spatial objection, the interaction and prayer with divine touch offer them a new self. So, it is a kind of their resistance. Now, Looking at the sacred grove, the sacred groves are the for the Dalit community can be considered defined as the piece of evergreen vegetation mostly dedicated to their forefathers or serpent, which has been approached with reverence by the communities for centuries. Karimadam, the pre-settlement, also had a grove which was dedicated to serpent worship. So when they came to the new settlement, that is MSK Nagar, they were kind of resisting by creating their own sacred geography by making a Vanadurga temple that they converted into a grove. So here I have used the Raymond Williams idea of the constant negotiation between the dominant, emergent and residual cultures. So the existence of the deity in the newly created settlement, that is in MSK Nagar, helps the Pulaya community to make a new culture of worshipping. So for them, it is a process and a practice to legitimate, consolidate and the ownership of their land through cultural practice. So it is a form of resistance. Now, coming to the social capital formation, here I have used the notion of social capital by Bodu and Coleman. The location contributes a lot in the differential access to social capital, since there is no broader association with the outside neighborhood and the network externalities are not favorable to break the historical advantages. So here I try to analyze the their attainment in education and occupation as two variables. I have formed age cohorts till 65 plus population and found that there is no significant upward mobility attained. In occupational distribution also, women are engaged as domestic workers, sweepers or cleaners. So the direction of occupational and educational mobility indicates some stigmatized and punitive representation of people in the urban settlements. So the access to precarious jobs like manhole cleaning, sewage cleaning, sweeping, etc., show some kind of peculiar process of othering due to the educational and occupational backwardness. The government welfarist agendas could not produce, therefore, a new specialty. We can say that the government welfarist agendas could not produce a new specialty to the people of MSK Nagar. So, coming to the conclusion, the major conclusions are that it seems to be literally true to characterize the process of urbanism at MSK Nagar in the framework of subaltern urbanism, rather unlike the mega cities in India. So it is not inappropriate to use the notion of subaltern urbanism for articulating the past of the Dalit settlement dwellers. The legality of the settlement could not bring any substantial change in the subalternity and speciality. Most of the time, the settlements are relegated into the fringes and are away from the development process. So there is lacking of the new speciality that could overcome changes in the form of producing a new self for the Dalit in the city fringes. So pre-settlement Karimadam, when you look at that, it is a kind of a refuge place. Occupationally, when you look at, they are into the precarious and unclean jobs. Hence, there is a varied nature of social exclusion and a physical and cultural abjectness. The new settlement does not change occupational dynamics or the caste speciality or produce a new speciality, since the access to social capital is very much limited. The caste acts as a powerful system of economic oppression and othering. The caste and class oppressions are intermixed and are essentially intersectional. So the people at slum settlement try to overcome the subalternity in several ways. The abjection through various resistance like Pentecostal prayers, making their own sacred geography, etc. So, however, it seems the representation of space in the modern secularized caste Kerala is a product of the privilege of the upper caste elite outgroup. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Those are three really excellent presentation, and I must apologize that we had to be, coming down heavy on the timekeeping, but we wanted to keep enough time for question and answers, and hopefully some of the details that got missed out can be addressed now. So yeah, I'll open the floor up to sort of questions. I think the way there is a place to ask questions, or you can put it in the chat box. I'll just ask the organizers. Probably it's in both places. You can raise your hands and then we can start taking some questions. So yeah, please go ahead, raise your hands and...
There's a participant, Atreya, who wants to raise their hand. So please unmute yourself and go ahead.
Yes.
Again, I guess it's better to like verbally ask, so it will be an interaction kind of thing. So firstly, regarding the Kerala model of development, there is a lot of literature on that. I would just like to say that regarding the broader literature on some slum resettlement in India, which comes from Delhi, like works of Gautam Bhan and Sanjay Srivastava, we see that all slums are getting like shifted to the urban fringes. And is it something specific about Dalit speciality? Or is it a general trend that you have located in Kerala? Because this is a wider trend that gets reflected in the broader literature that I have found during my fieldwork also in Melbourne. And secondly, to Jatin, I would want to ask you one question. That is, how do you, like, apart from the demographic and data that you have presented us and the realistic procedures, what do you, how do you specially contextualize the Dalit settlement as a category in Delhi? And how did that nomenclature or the normative aspect of being a Dalit emerge in the spatial context of Delhi? These are the two questions.
Thank you. Yeah. So,
could you just repeat the first question that you had asked, please? Regarding the speciality.
Jatin.
Yes. This is Aditya.
So, Jatin, I was asking that you talked about how the Dalit settlements have been made and how the state has not responded a lot and it was paternalistic. But I just wanted to know how the normative aspect of being a Dalit gets reflected in the spatial arrangement of these settlements. Like the identity of Dalit gets reflected in the spatial organization of this place. How do you understand that these places are Dalit settlements and not other kind of slums? How do you categorically separate these issues?
I got you. Got your question. Yes. So should I respond right now or should I take?
Yeah. Why don't you and then we'll take the more general question about what is specific to Dalit issues in a range of eviction issues.
So I'll just start by responding by giving a few examples, very recent examples. The very recent one came February only, or I think in January. So it's not Delhi based. So what about the Delhi settlements? And how this the Dalit settlement gets its identity. So there was a proposal by the Maharashtra cabinet to shun the tag of Dalit or Harijan or any kind of caste based or caste reflective nomenclature from the settlements in which the habitants are Dalit, and rather it had given examples of naming them through the names of Bhimnagar or which can also then be again traced up, but like Jyotipur Nagar or Jyoti Nagar, or there was another one which was I guess regarding Prakash Nagar. So this was from Maharashtra. In 2019 April, we see that the social welfare ministry in Delhi had actually proposed or had raised this proposal in front of the cabinet that there are at least by 2019 they said that there are at least.
Hi, Jatin. We cannot hear you. I think maybe there's a break in the signal.
So I'll just call Jatin up. In the meantime, can we go ahead with the next question?
Yes, please, if there are any more questions, please raise your hands. And just unmute yourself. We can also try to unmute you. Atiyah, I might just prompt people to sort of consider how do you connect up between a kind of a speciality analysis and categories, processes, events. I think that is one issue that seems to be coming up. So, but please raise your hands and ask your question. Now's the time. We have about 7 minutes more for in this Q&A. And if some of the presenters want to also pose questions to the other panelists, that's also okay. So if any of you want to, so if you can ask a crisp question and then a crisp answer back, yeah.
Can I do that now?
Yes, please speak up. Who is this? Sorry. I hope you're unmuted.
I was told that I was not audible then. What was the last point I was heard or
second question
was the last point that was audible, or should I just make a very brief comment on what the question was asked?
I think the question, as I understand it, was a very useful one, that how do you link a speciality understanding to the category of the Dalit. What kind of politics comes out when you look at it from a speciality perspective? And you were mentioning a particular set of government orders or reports. So
basically, a very brief comment on this, that there was a report also that actually the Dalits do not want their settlements or housing to be named after after them, or there should be any kind of identification based on the caste to their settlements or housings. For example, there was this report in Hindustan Times in 2019 again, that which said that the most of the students who do not use their surnames, a survey found out that those who are basically coming from the untouchable families to have anonymity for social amelioration, but this anonymity was taken away when the address of their residence was basically put on the official documents. So most of them, those had Ambedkar Nagar or Harijan Basti or such settlements, which were basically caste conscious nomenclature was there for the settlements, and that actually gave them this identity of otherwise, if you see what is the aspect of speciality in terms of what is the speciality aspect of the Dalit settlements, I would say that if you see the trajectory of the or the history of the settlement of the city of Delhi itself, you would see that the settlements of Dalits have been like separated or earmarked as a separate. Initially, when there was Old Delhi, you would find Chamarwada and Bhangiwada and all these settlements on the fringe of the old city. Then later we find that Raghapura and all these basically combined in the places like Karol Bagh and Pahar Ganj. However, later we find that these were not limited to the fringes or the certain regions. Many slums or many illegal or quote unquote illegal settlements also also had this accumulation of the Dalit settlements. And then later, if you see through the composition of the residents, one can then find out that what is the composition of the residents. Then on this basis, people like Shirdi Ganguly and all have made out their studies also and have marked that these settlements and because of the inhabitants who are Dalits were marked with the stigma or were marked with a particular certain kind of identity. So that is where I make somehow.
Okay. Are there any more questions? If you can raise your hands. I think since because we have just a couple of minutes, I'll just mention, can you all hear me?
Yes, Professor, we can hear you.
Yeah. So I'll just thank, I'm assuming there are no more questions, but if there are, please do intervene. Or maybe we can have, follow-up kind of conversations through email and WhatsApp. So I just want to first of all thank the hosts to put all this together. And as we were discussing in the session just before the kind of a more informal breakout session, that it may be a nice idea to have some kind of forum or space where all of you can compare notes, because obviously this kind of very fast 15 minutes is not enough. So I hope that some of you can take a lead on this and create some kind of a WhatsApp or other based groups and put together some of these papers in an interesting web space for people to add on. I just want to suggest one thing to leave a kind of question with all of you is to try to think of categories and ways of describing a particular situation on a process, which is non, which is, to put it crudely, because I haven't thought a counter word, which is non-spatial, right, or aspatial. And how does that link to other ideas that we have, when we see something, we say, oh, this is not historicized, but it's different from something being not being historicized, because we are also trying to break these kind of temporal linearities when we are thinking about space and spatiality. So I think one of the interesting things that each of you can do in your work is to use the material that you've got, the field work, and try to frame it in ways and see what happens in a sense. If you frame it in an ahistorical or an aspatial way, and then turn it around to see what does it then mean to do a spatial analysis. I think this is just it's almost like a bit of a game, but I think it's very helpful, because then when you start to do intensive, ethnographic work or field work, then you start to start to listen to what people are saying in terms of the way they describe their situation, or even ask questions of you as to why are you asking this question, why what is your interest in this whole process. So I think I'd like to just leave that with you, and as a kind of suggestion, both methodological and conceptual. And I think this may be one of the many things that, comes out of this conference on spatiality. So thank you very much. And I'd really like to again thank all the organizers and all of you who've taken time and effort to come and present your work. And I've read through the papers, at least the ones I could, and it was really nice. And I feel bad that we had only 15 minutes for discussion, but that is such as life. So thank you very much.
I would like to thank Professor Benjamin Solomon for his insightful inputs and the panelists for that captivating session.